So, this is not exactly a lecture, you know. The project we had at the beginning was a relatively a modest one. My long-time and very dear friend Frieda and Judith and the foundation with her had proposed that we set up a little conversation for which my book that has been just published in German and also in French, in fact, just a couple of months ago, would provide the starting point. And of course, the general theme would be, or the general idea would be, that we could seize that occasion or take up this this starting point to exchange ideas about the current situation in Europe and off Europe, how we analyze it, how we try to develop, I would say, positions, maybe even propositions or proposals that could be labeled left or even radical left in the current situation, which is certainly not something very easy to do. And this remains the objective, at least for me. Yeah. And this is also one reason why I don't want to take too much time, but I need some time nevertheless. So I'm asking you to cut me at some point, at a reasonable moment, because I really believe that the most important thing tonight should be to hear as many different voices as possible. Yeah. And I'm not expecting unanimity or automatic agreement, I would say. I'm more in the spirit, I would say. Of course, I'm not expecting something like a harsh, we'll see. I mean, perhaps there will be some relatively strong, or not to say violent, oppositions between different points of view here, which is absolutely normal, I believe, and inevitable. But I also hope that the confrontation can lead to some sort of clarification. And now, of course, something something new has taken place, which led us to reorganizing, and inevitably will also put its stamp, I would say, on my preliminary considerations, which is the vote of the citizens of the United Kingdom for what has been called the Brexit. So if the lecture had taken place yesterday, we could you could have said, who knows what's going to happen? Apparently, the polls were anticipating a very narrow result, and in a sense, unpredictable. And after all, it's not so narrow. I mean, we'll, but okay. So we must, as we say in French, à chaud, you know, when it's the matter is hot, not to say burning. We must try and make something with that, and draw from the event some lessons and perhaps rather some questions. So I agree that this is a very important turning point for all of us, for Europe as such. And I am completely convinced that it's a revealing event, and that makes visible, manifest some crucial aspects of the situation. However, the interpretation is not so simple. We're surrounded already now. After I arrived earlier today, I of course immediately opened my computer and went to read some of the commentaries on the press, so the French press, a little bit of the German press, the British, the Guardian, the New York Times, which has a huge head title. I will quote some of these formulas. And many of them, especially in the French press, take it for granted that we exactly know what has happened. And of course, some people in Britain as well, especially on the side, I would say, of the winners. So I noticed this formula from Nigel Farage: "The dawn is breaking on an independent United Kingdom." In a sense, I'm going to speak first against the seeming obviousness or clarity, whatever the adjectives you use, of course, of this result. So my first question will be, does this mean that Great Britain or the United Kingdom is leaving Europe, as the campaign said, or is stepping out, if you like, of the of Europe? And I want to say immediately, this is my conviction. I submit it for, of course, discussion. Not at all. It absolutely doesn't mean that. It doesn't mean that in the broad sense of the name, or of the name Europe. To borrow a category that was used a long time ago, but this is a text that became famous and rightly so, John Maynard Keynes, in his famous essay called The Economic Consequences of the Peace, published in 1919, I believe, was describing something he called a European system, not only a system of states, a social system, a system of nations and peoples. And of course, the system is no longer exactly the same. It's been profoundly transformed by the whole dramatic history of the 20th century and what came after. And of course, the European Union itself. But the system is there more than ever. It's a combination, a complex combination of interdependencies. And what has taken place yesterday or tonight, last night, is a change, of course, is a change, a transformation. Or it makes visible a transformation in the geometry or the geography of that system, on its institutional basis, to some extent. But Britain, or the United Kingdom, is more than ever part of that system and an important, decisive part. Now, of course, if we have time, this will perhaps come in the discussion, we'll have to try and say something about the relationship between centers and peripheries, to use another well-known terminology, applied to various elements, states and nations, which are part of that system. And we will have to take into account the fact that there are important states and nations in the European system, or in Europe in the broad sense, that occupy, I would say, a very complex situation, because they are both completely inside and deeply and strongly connected to other systems, which lay outside. In fact, the representation of Europe as a closed system or territory is a completely misleading one. And so maybe we'll see. I mean, Britain is going to find itself now in a different institutional position because, like some Balkanic states, which are of course smaller, but the recent events and regarding the question of refugees and migrations directly demonstrated that they are also an important part, sometimes a strategic part of the European system. And then there's a question of Ukraine, there's a question of Turkey, there's a question of Russia. I mean, this is part of Europe in the historic sense. Okay, this is relatively simple and I believe clear. But then comes, of course, the question that you will think is more decisive, whether Britain is now leaving Europe, not in this broad sense, historic sense, but in the narrow sense, that is, when you identify Europe with the European Union. European Union created immediately after World War II and then progressively expanded through a series of important changes and steps linked themselves to the world history. So I, this is a hypothesis that might be refuted, we'll see, but my guess is this won't be the case either. The French press, for example, echoing, in fact, declarations that were made repeatedly, and of course there were attempts at weighing on the ballot in Britain in the last days and weeks by various European leaders. I think Dr. Schäuble was especially vocal in this sense. The French president, Mr. Juncker, they all said something like, which Le Monde this morning or today, this afternoon, repeats. Either in the form, either you're in or you're out, but you can't be, have it both ways. And Le Monde writes in French, in French English, in Franco English, out, say out. Out means out, doesn't mean in, because we. If you read the whole editorial, you understand what this in fact means, among other things. It means, of course, Europe, this is a traumatic moment, event. It doesn't only concern the British citizens who will draw their own conclusions as they can from the decision that they have made. It also means something for Europe, so we cannot just do as if nothing had taken place. Just unfortunately, some of our friends and neighbors decided to part and go their own way. And we stay there, and we are still the same, essentially. So Le Monde is not as dumb and simple as that. They say we must profoundly rethink and reflect on the causes of this deplorable result. And the causes, of course, are not only across the channel because, and we've read tons of that, the Brits never really perceived of themselves as Europeans. They didn't really love, I read that, the European idea. They just had a pragmatic interest in making a deal with Europe. And now, in fact, they made a different choice for their own reasons. And no, what Le Monde writes is there are reasons in Europe itself. This is a negative result, and it's to a large extent, they don't hesitate to say it, and many politicians say the same, the result of the fact that Europe went a wrong way, if you like, and made bad choices. in a variety of domains, from institutions, how its internal democracy failed to convince the mass of the people that they were represented in the collective decisions, to other burning questions concerning security. They heavily insist on the question of security, which is a broad notion. I will return to that. It includes migrations, external borders, defense, and common, etc. So all this has to be rethought and rediscussed, provided this is the meaning of the editorial. The basic idea and the project as such remains the same. No radical change is needed. So I believe this is wrong, and this is my thesis. In fact, this will become clear progressively in the coming months, which is, of course, largely unpredictable. But I anticipate long and complex negotiations between, say, the European Union, the Commission, the Council of States, and the leading powers themselves, and Britain with its new government, we don't know whose objective and aim will be to determine, invent, I would say, the kind of association that will exist between Britain and the European Union, and the kind of association in that case, because Britain was used to be a member with certain specific characteristics and even something called sometimes privileges or special treatments. And not just the same situation as, if you like, Norway or Switzerland, which countries which never became, which have close, very close association ties with Europe in certain domains, but never became part of the EU. So it has to be invented, and of course this will give rise to very strong conflicts and oppositions and relationships of forces, and the result will be another form of interaction and influence. So you may have the impression that I'm now pushing le bouchon, as we say in French. I mean, the don't know what you say in English for that. I mean, the ball or the into the opposite direction. Nothing really changes, because it was already a conflictual and complex kind of articulation, and it's going to be another one. And of course, this is not my position. I do believe that what took place yesterday and consequences that are now to follow will have, of course, dramatic consequences on at different levels. I tried to list them under three headings. First, static, if you like, or institutional, and internal to the European Union. I think that you will see that most of what I say belongs to the category of so-called Euro-pessimism, and that's in a sense, what used to be called the, in French, l'Europe des États, the Europe of states, as opposed to a kind of federal or federalist-oriented construction, is weakened, because Great Britain was a strong, if not the strongest, advocate of a non-federal or non or even anti-federal type of European construction, and in a sense, what just took place is a culmination of that attitude with popular backing. And for some time at least, on the continental side, in order to face the crisis, there will be attempts at, I would say, reinvigorating the idea of supranational construction. Perhaps this is one of the, of course, unknowns of the situation, with only one part of the existing system, or if you like, giving some reality, some more reality, to the idea that that the European Union or the European system of states cannot be homogeneous. There must be degrees of association or belonging, even belonging. Already, of course, the distinction between the Eurozone and the non-Euro states hints in that direction. But as we know, already 20 years ago, very important, well-known German politicians, Dr. Schäuble, whom I was mentioning, and his colleague and friend Karl Lammers, devised plans for the construction of something called Kern Europa, which was also adopted at some point as a possible and even a necessary perspective by people who are more liberal or even more to the left. Habermas did support that idea several times. And I'm expecting that this is revived. But I do believe, and enough for this right now, this is also a matter of discussion, that the obstacles are huge, especially if you take the Eurozone as your starting point or your basis, because the Eurozone, in fact, is the space within which the contradictions in the last periods have grown to the extremes. And even if you succeed in pushing Greece outside, you won't suppress these contradictions because they are much wider than that. And above all, we know that, or we've learned, or we've began to learn that an advance in the direction of a more federal or more federalist construction needs yes, absolutely demands a kind of social integration, social and economic integration, that, to say the least, does not exist yet and will not be easily created. So there are unknowns aspect there and probably a renewed tension. Second heading, I would say, there will be and I'd return, this will be my theme for the rest of the presentation, there will be also dynamic consequences. I hope to be more precise in a minute, but I just want to say that, of course, this event from last night shows and indicates that we are entering a new phase, a new moment in. That's the title of my book, of course, but I'm not the only one, far from, who uses this category. It's a new phase in the development of the structural crisis of Europe. Some people say existential. Okay, so that's something different from a provisional a crisis, the kind of crisis we've always been told could be used in the end to, in fact, push the project further. And why that? Because Brexit, as I take it, cannot be defined as I've just been doing, quoting the newspapers, the fact that one country or one nation is stepping out or leaving Europe, considered as a system of states. What is taking place is the fact that a European people, a nation in the sense of a people, a European people, like all the others, not less European than any of the others, not less European than the Greeks or the Germans or the French. Of course, with all its internal contradictions and tensions, including, as we know, but this is also not a British privilege or singularity, it's ethnic, internal differences. Look at Spain. I mean, look at, in fact, several other cases. So a European people has expressed, I would say, a majority opinion against the existing political system in Europe. And what, of course, is revealing, is important, is this is a majority opinion. So I said a moment ago, it's not 50 against 50, but still, of course, the majority is not overwhelming. Because when you go from, when you start trying to analyze, and we'll know better in a little bit of time, we'll have more precise analyses concerning the distribution of the votes, I would say regionally, of course, socially, London versus the working classes of the Midlands and further north. In terms of ages, that's of course, I believe, very important. But to stay with the regional differences, of course, we already have commentaries on the fact that Scotland voted 62% for Europe, and England 53% against. So these tensions are crucial. I take it that they have their equivalent everywhere in Europe today. So we'll have, of course, calls from certain political forces, already Madame Le Pen in France, Geert Wilders in the Netherlands, and they'll probably be followed by others, possibly, not in the East, and not in Eastern Europe. We'll say we need our own referendum. I remember at this point that after the 2005 referendums, I don't know how you say, on the project of the European Constitution that was rejected, as you remember at the time, with also a significant majority both in France and the Netherlands, German Chancellor, was he still Chancellor at the time? I guess so, or maybe he had just left, Helmut Schmidt, wrote a very interesting article that you may retrieve. He said explicitly, if we had, I mean, Spain was the exception for a number of reasons, but if you had a similar referendum everywhere in Europe, you would have a majority against the constitutional treaties in a number of other places. So this is not purely French, this is not purely Dutch. And so I take it that the with all its specificities, the British vote expresses something, a deep contradiction between certain parts, and they're absolutely not to be neglected or stamped just with such etiquettes as nationalist, or on the other hand, simply praised as the forces that resist the new technocratic rule in Europe. It's more complicated than that, but it's a significant and meaningful expression of the deep conflict between the populations and the political system. And that is why I submit that we are entering, in fact, a new phase of the structural crisis, and this is revealing. And third, there are, how long did I speak? And third, there are Of course, geopolitical consequences that cannot be ignored, even if, again, on this side, there are many unknowns. So I will not pretend that I'm an expert. I'm just a citizen. But I would like to submit questions on two points, giving no answer. First, the transatlantic relationship. I have the feeling that lots of people, including perhaps in Britain, tend to interpret the situation in such terms. Perhaps precisely because they perceive, this is part of our perception of Britain, both from inside and outside, that Britain had this privileged relationship with the United States that was carried on, maintained, until recently in dramatic circumstances with effects that are not negligible, such as, for example, the support of the Blair government to the Iraq war and intervention. This is one example among others. So you might believe that something will return to the previous situation in that sense. And I think this is not sure at all. The world situation has considerably changed. The United States are changing profoundly themselves, both their internal and their geopolitical orientation. And I submit that we could witness exactly the opposite, that reason why Obama and other American politicians, and I don't think they are only on the Democratic side, expressed warnings against that. In fact, it's one of the forms, not the only one, under which specific ties of political, economic influence and interdependency between Europe and the United States is shaken and perhaps partially dissolving. And the other geopolitical question or geopolitical economic question on which I cannot prevent from asking questions, even if I don't have the capacity to treat the question, has to do with the position of the, I would say, political financial European system in global in global capitalism. The situation was not apparently that you had the euro and the project to build around the euro a political economic capacity to weigh, to be an important weight in the global situation, and on the other side the Brits who would play their own singular game. As we know, this was rather a kind of coupling. It was rather a kind of coupling. And the fact that the a good deal of the financial capacities of Europe was relying not on the euro alone, but on the coupling of the euro and the city of London, not to mention, of course, but that's not negligible, the fact that a good deal of the shadow banking and the hidden side of the financial system, the tax evasions and all that, was linked to that. So to say that the euro will now possibly enter a new moment of difficulties and crisis is perhaps hasty, but there cannot not be consequences on that side. How long did I speak?
Just 40 minutes.
40 minutes? Okay, so I will have to cut very severely.
No.
Look at that. I mean, so okay. So I hope I'm not bothering you too much. So I had planned three points plus a kind of conclusive remarks. So I'll skip many things and go through that. I see three types of problems that we must try to address again in the light of the recent events, but also trying to collect gather, I would say, our previous analysis. And please don't believe I think that in the book beautifully translated by Frida, I already proposed a complete system of analyze interpretations and answers. But yes, on the other hand, I'm here trying to repeat or to once again propose some guiding lines which are pretty much already there in my book. So first question, democracy. And democracy in close and direct interpenetration, if you like, with the problems of so-called populism and nationalism. So a lot has to be said about that, but I think that more than ever, we need to seriously address the questions covered by this floating category, populism, used in, again, once again, yesterday or this morning, to describe what takes place in Britain. The populists have won. They waged a populist campaign. So most of the time, of course, this is negative. It's a negative description, some of which elements are true, of course, but others are misleading and caricatural. And as I said already at the time, of course, I oscillated in my terminology. I said in 2010, when the first mass demonstrations in Athens were taking place, we need a European populism. I soon realized that this was a kind of oxymoronic or a paradoxical combination of terms that produced more confusion than clarification. So I moved from there to the idea that we needed a European counter-populism. But of course, in the idea of a counter-populism, wanted to keep the idea that certain forms of radical democratic mobilization of the citizenry are in fact needed, and paradoxically they emerge and in a manner that is worrying not only on the left but also on the right. So we need to intensify our efforts to deconstruct, as some philosophers would say, the confusions, the mixture, the amalgamations around the name populism. We need to see that there is populism even where it is not called like that, such. For example, I suggested that when at the time of the last negotiations with the Greeks, and that began very early, European governments, to begin with the German one and the French one, explained, in fact, organized, set up press campaigns to explain to the citizens that if we accepted what the Greeks demanded, restructuring of their debt, this would be at, of course, the expense of ordinary people everywhere in Europe, the taxpayers. This is typically a populist argument in some sense. So populism is not only on the side of opposition forces. There is an official populism, and there are, of course, antagonistic forms. There is a right-wing and a left-wing populism. But above all, we need to analyze what, forgive me for a reminiscence from the old times of Marxist debates. I would call the contradictions within the people. Populism is a symptom of those contradictions, and from this I draw the conclusion that we certainly need to very strongly oppose some of the so-called populist forces, especially in this country, in France, Madame Le Pen, Pegida, AfD, and so on. But we cannot just dismiss the category and the underlying problems. These underlying problems have to do with the old and still very important notion of the sovereignty of the people. And by people here, I understand the majority of citizens. So the question becomes, are our citizens in France, Germany, and Great Britain wrong when they believe, and this is increasingly the case, that a transnational political project, a federal, if you like, a system of political powers and representative bodies or instances, in fact, in practice, for them, for the mass of the citizens, means a new degree in the disposition, in the suppression of their rights and capacities to govern themselves, or simply to weigh on the decisions of the ruling class and elite. And the answer is no possible doubt. If transnationalization means the kind of combination that the European Union has now produced of a quasi independence or monopoly, if you like, of executive power in different forms, the Commission, the Council of the Heads of State, a huge and practically monstrous techno structure behind which lies the increasing influence of what I try to find a category I would call a shadow citizenry. The shadow citizenry is the influence, the name I find. It's inspired by an article that had been written by a French pundit some time ago in the occasion of whichever election, in which Mr. Duhamel, that's his name, had written, in fact, there are two constituencies. One is visible. These are the citizens. They vote for this or that party or that leader. And then there are the big corporate bodies, the lobbies, if you like, or the international financial system, which also votes, in fact, or pushes for some of them. And of course, this has become increasingly powerful. What Mr. Hollande promised to attack when he was elected, and in 48 hours or 24 hours he reneged on his promise to attack the power of finance, which is embodied in the European construction. So if that is the form of transnationalization, citizens who view national sovereignty, or a return to national sovereignty as a kind of defense mechanism, cannot be entirely dismissed. They cannot be entirely wrong. On the other hand, of course, I will talk about that. I hope we discuss about that. I don't believe that there is any serious possibility to maximize the capacity of citizens in Europe today, in each singular country, even the most powerful countries like Germany, or transnationally, to control the political system, and more generally the power system that governs them, if they remain isolated from one another, or if they return to a kind of mythical absolute independence of nations that in fact never really existed or was linked to global conditions that no longer exist, particularly imperialism. So the problem becomes, what kind of alternative can we propose to that discourse of the return to national sovereignty if we admit that there is something true or important in any case that is expressed like that? How to invert the tendency, the general tendency, towards something that some political theorists call the post-democratic states of today? And of course, the key question here has to do with confronting nationalism, confronting nationalisms in Europe with some sort of popular collective alternative, I would say. Not a condemnation from atop, but an alternative project from below. And I know that these are very general and generic terms. But one important element in that is, I believe to understand that the nationalist feelings, as expressed in Great Britain or Germany or France, have much to do with, I'm trying to find the good formulation, with something like, in French I would say, a demande d'état, calling for more state, or better said, for more state protection. For more state protection. That is, with the idea that the state doesn't protect us enough, and if it was returned, so to speak, to the national framework, it would become a better protection for the citizens against precarity, precariousness, or real or imaginary cultural threats. And of course, this cannot be the case, of course. I mean, this, I think, cannot be the case in that form, because the states, I don't say they are absolutely powerless, but they are no longer the only, and perhaps not even in many cases, the most influential and important agents, if you like, in world politics. And also because in such situations where there's a strong demand for more state protection, but there is an increasing incapacity of the states, the national state machines, to actually isolate and protect the population from, say, the dangers of globalization, generally speaking. So that produces very strong forms of resentment, and resentment and anxiety, and the combination of resentment and anxiety produces xenophobia on mass scale. Okay, so that would possibly lead me to considerations on the question of migrations and borders, which I will skip. That will possibly return in the discussion. So the last point that I want to mention has to do with the material constitution of Europe in what it has become today. So I borrow this expression, as in the book Material Constitution, from Sandro Mezzadra, who developed it in very important essays. And Sandro Mezzadra himself, of course, borrows it from certain juridical political tradition, which includes problematic names such as Carl Schmitt and others. It's not a purely juridical notion of the Constitution. Juridically speaking, of course, the Constitution of Europe is a mess. It's a mess because it's made of treaties which have been added to one another. But politically speaking, of course, material constitution of Europe is a shaky combination, which I tried to call pseudo-federalism, of supranational elements, which include, of course, the European Commission and other bodies, The European Parliament is one of them, but it is really limited to very symbolic powers, as we know. And the courts of justice, this is very important. This has increasingly important effects on, say, the building of something like a European society in many different domains. There are two, in fact, justice courts. I don't give you again the whole story that you know, and they're weighing, and the one that the European Court of Justice in the last period has been weighing very strongly, in fact, in the sense of the transformation of labor legislation and contracts in the neoliberal direction. So it's absolutely not politically neutral. The euro system, monetary system, the European Central Bank, is also part, of course, of that supranational side, and at least for the countries which belong to the eurozone, but also for the others, it has acquired an enormous power. And what is interesting, particularly interesting, I believe, I anticipated that with others, or I repeated what some others were saying years ago, against, in a sense, a kind of leftist common sense that was very very broadly accepted among, I'd say, leftists and radicals in Europe, in Greece, and in other countries. It's not the case that the monetary and economic policies advocated by the German government and the Finance Ministerium in Germany and the European Central Bank are just two sides of the same coin. And we see here contradictions, potential conflicts emerging, and not only about Greece, but about the ways to preserve the euro. And it's not impossible that, as I said before, this is again very strongly on the agenda. So on one side, you have all these supranational elements. They're not to be wiped out. They're not to be wiped out. They've already began to considerably determine, in fact, the lives and the political issues in all our countries. But of course, on the other side, you have the kind of reassertion of the power of nation states and the idea of the Europe of nations I alluded to at the beginning, that especially after 1990, yes, managed to overrun, I would say, the federalist tendencies. Now, what we observe now, if you take these two sides, is the fact that not only they are heterogeneous, they don't speak the same language, and they don't act systematically in agreement. So of course, there are power relations. And right now, it's apparently the system of states that is stronger than the federal or quasi-federal system. But in fact, taken jointly, they are now, so to speak, over-determined, or they're interplay, their permanent internal conflict is overdetermined by, I would say, lines of fracture and rift that have become created in the European system in the last period. So we first observe the rift between North and South, the system of creditor states and the system of debtor states, and the question, and then we observed other types of rifts, particularly between East and West Europe in terms of discussing the issue of refugees. In fact, I believe that things are more complicated than that, because the rifts are internal to many of the European nations themselves. But still, you may see something like the emergence of different poles of power. So what I suggested is there is a pole of power around the European Central Bank. There's clearly a pole of power around Germany as the hegemonic state in Europe, the so-called reluctant hegemon of Europe, as some would say. Yeah? And it's clearly something difficult because Germany is certainly more powerful than any of the other European states, but it's not able to impose its own policies against all the others, especially when the others take the form of negative policies, I would say, or passive resistance, as you could see in the case of refugees, but we might return to that. And then there's something like a missing pole, so for which, of course, the French vicissitudes in the last period are particularly important and significant, because France is the sick man of Europe, I mean, accept it or not. I mean, the expression that was used in, like it or not, that was used in the 19th century for another country. I don't go into any detail. You probably follow the situation in France these days. Of course, I see the kind of return of class struggles, there is no other word for that, as something very positive. And I see the fact that after others, in a slightly different manners, less massive than Spain, perhaps, but nevertheless significant, with Nuit Debout, we had our own forms of democratic, radical democratic challenge, which creates, in fact, a problem that the French state is not able to resolve, at least now. And there are temptations of resolving it in a violent manner. But the consequence of that is France is quickly and perhaps already becoming, and perhaps already become non-governable as a political system. And of course, this is not something without consequences for Europe as such. It's part of the material constitution I was alluding to. Behind all that, of course, are the huge consequences of the turn that was taken after 1990, when Europe adopted a kind of implicit economic political constitution, which I'm not the only one to use that terminology, and I know it produces shocking effects on some people, perhaps not here, but in other places. When I said after 1990, Europe adopted a kind of inverted Soviet political system. And that is a political system which is entirely subjected to the rule or the law of an economic dogma. Except in the case of the Soviet Union, it used, and the socialist system, it was planning with all its subsequent transformations. And in the case of Europe, is the so-called unbiased, free, or unlimited competition. And now, of course, we can see that what this produces. This produces, after 20 years now, almost 25 years, we see that it not only it doesn't produce a convergence of the economic and social systems, but it produces generalized competition at the European levels between nations, between workers, between territories in particular. And this is one of the elements that clearly played a role in the British debate, because as you know, one of the populist themes was the negative impact of migrations in Britain. But the migrations they were talking about were not only, and perhaps not essentially, the migrations from the Middle East and Africa. They were intra-European migrations. So serious sociological and economic analyses seem to show that this is not something that, in fact, took away jobs from the British, or not in significant numbers. But the famous Polish plumber, as we call him in France, that is 300 migrants from Eastern Europe, in fact, in Britain, are a symbol or a kind of visible token of the fact that the Europe we live in is one in which competition among wage workers and generally speaking the working population works continuously in the direction of lowering the social standards and the protections of labor. So above the Europe of states, you have in fact the Europe of banks and the financial system, and under the Europe of state, you have a population with class characteristics, of course, that is strongly divided within itself. Okay, I think I should now really conclude. If we had time, we would try and locate what we observe today in a long history of the transformations of the European project. It's of course important that Britain entered the European Union at the end of the first great historical moment, the time of the first great turning point, when the competition between the two models, the financial model and the more protective social Europe, became, of course, the key issue. And in that sense, of course, Thatcher is the important name, because and her successors, because it's a symbol of the fact that this neoliberal policy became more decisive and influential in France, as in Europe. As I said a moment ago, what we see now means that the crisis opened in 2008, but which in fact I see as a kind of after effect of the revolution or counter-revolution of 1990, has become irreversible. It will not, it doesn't stop to multiply its dimensions and to produce internal oppositions that are now largely unpredictable. So several terms are in use, not only among us, but around us, to try and define what is at stake in such a structural crisis. You have refoundation, or new foundation, meaning implicitly of the European Union as it exists. You have reconstruction, so this goes one step further. It means that perhaps the European Union is dead or will progressively collapse. So if the alternative is not the nihilistic prospect of a new era of more or less violent conflicts, and in any case, strong competition between states and populations of Europe, another type of collective construction or European community has to be invented in Europe. And this, of course, leads to the third possible term, which is revolution. So this is also, very interestingly, a term that is being used by people, analysts, intellectuals who are not Marxists. They don't read Rosa Luxemburg or not even Franz Mehring. They speak from humanist points of view, or liberal, left liberal points of view. I could give names. What the idea of revolution here means is not that you need a kind of violent uprising of European populations, which by some kind of miracle would join forces against the system. I don't see, maybe I'm wrong, but I don't see any situation of that kind on the agenda. But what I do see, and in any case I advocate, is the necessity to invert or reverse the priorities of the European construction as they were included in the last generation of treatises, in particular the Maastricht treaties, and above all the idea, the absolute law of competition among Europeans themselves as a precondition for any reconstruction or refoundation. And in my opinion, subjected to discussion, this also means that we, and when I say we, this is a potential European left, or this is the new left that would eventually emerge across the national borders in Europe, including, of course, the British themselves. They are not out with a twofold, permanently combined objective of struggle, a necessity to fight permanently on two fronts, if you like, on two battle lines, against nationalisms and xenophobia, which are on the rise everywhere in each and every of our countries, but also, of course, decidedly against the revolution from above that Habermas has called the birth or the ascent of post-democratischer exekutiv föderalismus, which some other European leaders in the next period, and Schäuble had also proposed that some time ago, will try to, I would say, costume, I mean, to habiller, what do you say? Do you say that in English? Yes, to class with a democratic facade. Democratic facade. There will be proposals in that sense. Perhaps the election of a European president at universal suffrage. But in any case, also most certainly with a development of the kind of security state that our politicians believe can be the common ground on which the various tendencies or the various groups of the populations could be reconciled. So permanent struggle on these two fronts with no choice. I mean, perhaps at some point a tactical necessity to specifically address the question of xenophobia or the question of the material constitution. But in fact, what I believe is you cannot address the first if you don't address the second. And you cannot address the second, of course, if you don't address the first as well. Sorry for the length of that very boring discourse.